And so I found myself pretty disillusioned with corporate life and what these big companies were doing. So for the last 8 years, I've worked with founders. I've worked inside their businesses. I've sat on their boards. I've dated founders. My life has been founders for 16 hours a day. And what that taught me was what it takes to be a good founder and what it takes to build a really great business that's going to scale to a kind of 100 million global level.
Welcome back, everyone, to another episode of Tech Times Exclusives. Today, we're talking with Orr Vinegold, the founder of Unrest, which Unrest helps business founders build consumer-focused startups with ethics at their heart. They're very focused on sustainability and educating business owners, potential business owners, people with great ideas. So, Orr, thank you so much for joining us today.
Pleasure, Chris. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. So, let's jump right in, Orr. If you could please just give us a quick background on yourself and a little bit about what Unrest does.
Yeah, sure. I'll weave the two together. So, I started my career working for big brands that everybody knows, people like Gillette, Braun, and L'Oreal. And very quickly, I realized that these companies were doing pretty substantial damage. You know, Procter & Gamble, if you've ever bought one of the razors from Gillette, you know that plastic that stuff comes in. That stuff is just not going to degrade in about a million years on the planet. And they're selling billions of these products a year. Anytime I'd go diving or seeing this kind of stuff in the oceans, it became very clear to me that these companies weren't being very responsible with the materials that they were using and how they were working around the world. And that just felt at odds with my own personal values. Mm-hmm. I didn't think that that's how we should treat the world. And L'Oreal, I think as everybody now knows, the impact of the big four beauty companies on women's mental health has been pretty pretty tragic. It's a real tragedy. And I saw some really sad reporting on the correlation between the amount of money that big four beauty companies spend and what happened to women's mental health, eating disorders, etc. around those countries. And so I found myself pretty disillusioned with corporate life and what these big companies were doing. So for the last 8 years, I've worked with founders. I worked inside their businesses. I've sat on their boards. I've dated founders. My life has been founders for 16 hours a day. Right. And what that taught me was what it takes to be a good founder and what it takes to build a really great business that's going to scale to a kind of 100 million global level. I saw this amazing learning and I saw that the world was also shifting towards the values that I had. So consumers wanting ethical products, consumers wanting to cause less damage to the society they live in and the environment that we operate in. And so I wanted to bring all of that together and help the next generation of founders come through and support them with money, resources, and time so that they have a better chance of succeeding. So in its shortest form, Unrest is about helping the next 540 globally scalable companies be more ethical, get bigger, and help their founders run those businesses in a modern way.
Okay, yeah, I agree with you. You know that it's very important. It's very the way, as we've spoken before, the way that businesses have been run for as long as I'm sure you and I can either one remember is just, bottom line. And that's just it. It's like, give me mine and then, we'll keep moving. And it's come at a cost that, as far as the experts say, within the next 15 or 20 years may be irreversible. So, I appreciate that you guys are stepping in and actually, and it's one thing to advocate and to call names or tag people on social media, but to actually get in and say, okay, we're going to educate you. Like that's what's been missing, I think, for the last couple decades is just basic education on why not to do it and how to do it better.
Yeah, exactly. And I kind of applaud you guys at Tech Times for covering this story and stories like it. I think it's, I think we all have to come together as a global community, to be honest, to make the shift. Because look, we're gonna you know, we're going to launch 540 companies over the next sort of 7 years. That's a drop in the ocean of what we need to do. So part of our wider mission at Unrest is that we have to inspire other incubators, accelerators, other investors to think this way and demand that founders bake in ethical morals into their businesses. Mm. And you know, the thing that's really the thing that's really helpful nowadays is that when you look at the millennial generation and you look at the generation who are coming behind us, they are, you know, the generation of Greta and the generation of, you know, the Zoomers, as we call them, they are 10 times more driven by ethical, sustainable thinking than we are. So, you know, they're not going to want to work in a company if it's right. not actually doing this stuff. And they're not going to be starting businesses that aren't ethical. So the thing for investors is also to think, if you don't care about that, you're not going to be able to have the best founders in your portfolio. So right. there's a kind of cycle here that the world is changing. And it's kind of driven by millennials a bit, but certainly the next generation, they are going to turbocharge this. So yeah, I mean, it's a good space to be. You're kind of future-proofing yourself in a way.
Right, absolutely. Yeah, I think it's coming, you know, not a moment too late.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, literally now is the time, right?
Yeah, absolutely. But like I said, you jumped in about 8 years ago, right?
So I've been working with founders for the last 8 years, and I've been doing that like inside their businesses. So, you know, I was a head of marketing, I was sitting on their boards, and Unrest was launched about a year ago. Oh. We're now on to our second cohort. So we're still super new, which is really exciting. And now we're just ready to tell the world about what we're trying to do. So we're in our second cohort, and we've got companies in our cohort that help people transition to eating less meat, for example, or help tackle the problem of, I don't know if you know this, but like, you know, 5 million mothers still die today at childbirth, and right. a lot of those deaths are avoidable. So mm-hmm. we have a startup that's working on how do you actually help mothers and educate them to avoid those kind of things happening. So it's really exciting, the kind of businesses we have. And yeah, we're looking for more inspiring founders.
Well, that's fantastic. So for those of you watching that's got a great idea, hang out a little, and a little bit later we'll talk about how you can absolutely take advantage of Unrest. So just a moment ago, you mentioned the terms incubator and accelerator. Yeah. Now, I'm sure for you, that's, you know, probably something you hear every day, if not multiple times a day. But for most of us on this end, yeah. You know, I know incubator for chicken eggs, and I know accelerator in a car. Like that's what I know. So if you could please maybe give us a little layman's definition, if you will, of those. Sure. Those terms, please.
Yeah, I mean, look, the investment space is just full of terminology, and it's mm-hmm. like, you know, it's actually not that complicated. It's pretty simple. People just put words and stuff. And it's the key thing, really, that everyone in investment space talks about, whether it's an incubator, an accelerator, or a seed round or a series B round, all they're really talking about is what stage is your business at? Mm-hmm. And by stage, we mean, idea. So it's just you probably at home in your bedroom with an idea. Right. That's super, super early. Mm-hmm. And that's typically where an incubator would help. And you may raise a little bit of money from friends and family. So people call that a pre-seed round. So if you're taking like 50K, for example, that's super, super early. We don't play in that space. That's much earlier than us. There are a ton of great incubators out there that do that, and a ton of great investors that will help you at that point. We're at the next stage. So the next stage is really, once you've got your idea and you've developed it to the point where you've got a name, you probably have a bit of a brand, you're maybe even selling a little bit of your product. So that's where we come in. So the stage after that, and that's, we are an accelerator. So our job is basically to, take an idea that's already pretty formed and mm-hmm. just help it move really quickly. So kind of accelerate it, i.e. get more customers, get more investors, hire a team, we're at that kind of stage. And then everything that comes after us is typically investors. So venture capital will be putting in millions of dollars and millions of pounds and euros into your business and kind of turbocharging that. That's the kind of liftoff rocket ship stage. And so we kind of shepherd you from this stage to this stage.
Okay, yeah. Well, thank you very much for that. I think I figured it out, you know, about halfway through. And it now I feel like, you know, the stupid kid in class, because it's so obvious now, you know, incubator, obviously. I don't want to say you're sitting on an idea.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just not ready for the world yet, type thing.
Totally, exactly, yeah.
You guys come in once, you know, once the you know, the deer has its legs or whatever, and you come in, it's like, okay, this is the way we're going.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Okay, good.
You got it. Yeah.
Okay, well, yeah, then what you guys are doing for these companies is, you know, I try not to get too personal on this platform or whatever, but being the co-founder or the head of a couple of, I'm not going to call them failed, because it's a horrible word, but you know, the things just, well, you know, they died in incubation, more or less, right? They never got accelerated. And it's sad, you know, couldn't even make an omelet out of most of them. But so yeah, so someone coming from, you know, with that experience to where once you feel like, okay, this is ready to go. But for most of us, we don't know the next thing to do. You know, it's like you post on Facebook or you know, that's basically as far as it goes. Do I have money for a billboard? No. What do? Do I have money to run ads in newspapers? Who? Nobody does that shit. You know, so it's like there is a point for a lot of good ideas, I think, that's where they end, is right after incubation, where acceleration should start.
That's exactly right. That's a huge point of failure. Yeah, you've nailed it.
Yeah, I've experienced it. Yeah, it's as real as anything. But yeah, so, you know, we talk about, you know, sustainability and these things. As far as, you know, a startup company, and, you know, like you said, you know, most of these younger founders or these younger people with great ideas, you know, they're very focused, obviously, on sustainability and, you know, being the best person that they can be and providing the best product possible. For our viewers who, you know, may be in this position, do you have any advice for them to move from maybe their stalled incubated idea to actually get it to where it could be, maybe slowly start moving forward?
Yeah, that's a great question. I was literally on a call with someone yesterday. So I obviously people know what I do. So it's probably a bit like being a doctor or a lawyer, right? You get like your friends of friends. I've got a friend who's setting up a business. Can you talk to them for half an hour? I get that all the time. So I have these conversations like probably every day. And I think a little bit like with life, there is the rules of the game. Mm-hmm. And then there is the magic. And I always tell founders, understand the rules of the game and then understand what it is that you're bringing, i.e. the magic, the little sprinkle of creativity or ingenuity that you're bringing. And so the rules of the game are, for example, if you want to build a marketplace, which is a conversation I had last night. So you want to help sustainable consumers connect with sustainable producers for like beauty products or like flowers or food products. Now, what you're building is a marketplace. So marketplace businesses, and you're in the middle, you're like the Amazon, right? You're just making that connection. Mm-hmm. So marketplaces just have general rules about them. And so I would just read up, like, Google is your friend, number one. Right. Read up about marketplace businesses, like spend a week just immersing yourself and mapping out all the different businesses. And that's just you understanding the rules of the game. And how does this work? The second thing I say to people is stay hyper-focused on the problem that you're trying to solve. And typically the problem lies with the consumers. So for example, let's just continue with this. If you really struggle to find ethical food and you wanted a supermarket that provided ethical food, but you just didn't have one. So you saw a problem that you wanted to solve. Now go and speak to like 20 people who feel the same way that you do about this problem. So 20 other people who are looking for an ethical supermarket, for example, or an ethical marketplace, and invite them for dinner. I just say, like, have casual conversations like we're having, just speak to as many people as possible and understand the problem and the consumers who face this problem. Because if you can find 20 people, it's likely that you could find 100 people. And if you can find 100 people, you may have a market that's really, really big. So just be dead focused on what you're trying to solve. And once you've really understood that, you can start thinking, what's the best way to solve the problem for them? And how much are they willing to pay if I solve this problem for them? And then you start asking them questions like, if this product existed, how much would you pay for it?
Right.
Would you pay 20% more than what you're paying today? 30% more, 40% more? What's your kind of ceiling? And then you understand, right, is there a problem that's big enough that can make me money here? Mm-hmm. and can do good for the world? So you just take it step by step effectively. But and then, you know, there are people out there who want to help. So incubators, accelerators, angel investors, like I will say to people, just like, don't be shy. Just go out and talk to people, like drop people on LinkedIn a message and say, look, I need 10 minutes of your time. I have this thing. I'd love to just pick your brain. And the one thing I always say to people is Google the lean canvas and make a lean canvas for yourself. So just type into Google lean canvas. It's a super, super self-explanatory document. It's a one pager where you just put everything down on one page, your whole idea just on one page. And you just have, that's your like Bible in the early days. And you just share that around with people.
Okay, well thank you, Orr. That's great advice. I was listening intently, and yeah, I'm definitely going to put some of those practices to work. So for our viewers again, that's watching, you know, and they're thinking, okay, you know, this is great. It sounds, you know, like this is something I want to do, but you know, it's much like the cell phones in the 2000s or maybe even NFTs today. You know, it's like it sounds good, but I don't know. And now you look, everyone has a cell phone. And by 2040, I would imagine everyone has an NFT. So at this point in time, people are saying, that's great, but it's infancy. So for the viewers who may be a little bit skeptical, you can look this up. It's public domain. The Cantor Consultant Report revealed that purpose-driven brands grow at twice the speed. So, or if you could please tell us why that is, and maybe a little deeper into what is the importance of just a purpose-driven branding and product marketing.
Oh, yeah, I think that's a great question. And I think there's two things you touched on. Well, it's a big question. So I think let's take the context for a second. You're right that in the late 80s and early 90s, there were a lot of skeptics about what the internet could do for people. And you know, a lot of early investors into things like Google, even Facebook, AOL, etc., were seen as sort of, are you potentially crazy, potentially pioneering? And so they're the same coin, different sides. Mm-hmm. And now we're seeing this huge cultural shift towards sustainability, morals, greener business, impact, whatever you want to call it. They're all fundamentally the same thing. And we see that just across the world. It's fascinating to watch. So there is a cultural shift happening, and there's a ton of evidence for it. So if you accept that fact, then the next logical step is that in every cultural shift, in every revolution, effectively, there are a ton of new businesses that are created. So in the last revolution, we had Google, Amazon, Facebook, In this revolution, we're already seeing Tesla as the standout from our batch, and there will be others. So this revolution will be defined by businesses that have impact at the heart of what they do. Right. So I guess the reason why circling back to your question, the reason why these companies are growing more quickly, the reason why Tesla is now the world's most valuable car company, even though it makes 8% of what Toyota makes in terms of output, is multiple reasons. So one, they can attract the best talent. So super smart people want to go and work for ethical businesses. Here's a piece of evidence for that point. Apple recently lost their top three engineers working on their secret car project. So Apple's developing a car in Silicon Valley. They lost three of their top car executives who all went to green automated car companies. So, you know, and that is happening at all levels. You look at data from young people and where they want to work. They don't want to work in non-ethical businesses anymore. So if you want the best talent, you need to be ethical. Right. And the reverse of that is if you're ethical, you've already got the best talent.
Right.
Number two, consumers want to buy ethical products. So again, Tesla's a great example. The demand by consumers is so high, they can't meet that demand. And so when investors look at Tesla and look at their share price, they say there's a huge pent-up demand for electric cars and Tesla is the leader in the same way that Google was the leader. Right. So they're the next Google. So consumers want that. And there's a ton of data for that. There was a Pew Research poll conducted, global research, 20,000 respondents. And it said, what kind of world do we want to return to after the pandemic? And 80% plus of people in the US, the UK, European countries, China, India, responded with, we want to come back to a more sustainable and ethical world. Mm-hmm. It was global consensus by everyday people that they want a better world. And so when you have 80% of the world saying they want something,
right,
that is going to create a huge amount of demand for these businesses. So what that means is if there's a small number of these ethical businesses and a huge amount of consumer demand, they are going to be able to attract customers more easily, more quickly, and they're going to be able to charge a higher price. So they're of course going to grow more quickly. So it's like, you know, there's a gold rush coming, and some people know that it's coming and some people don't. And we are hopefully supporting those that see that there's a gold rush coming in this big shift. And we just help founders build their businesses so that they can be a home for all those people who want to spend money with those businesses and all those people who want to work in those businesses. So, man, that was a long answer.
I thought it was a long question. No problem.
I'm sure there was more in that question that I didn't get to. That was the start.
I think you covered it all. Yeah. So for those that have been convinced, how can our viewers take advantage of Unrest?
We're not even in the business of convincing people. I think it's like, it's like a gradient, right? Like when we think about the last revolution, which was 30, 40 years ago, there's still people today who aren't on the internet. So like in the classic like shifting of technology, you have the early adopters and then you have, it's kind of an offensive name for them, but they're called the laggards, the people who are kind of right at the back. They kind of come to the new innovations last. And there's always that curve of like who adopts first. Right. And we're still seeing 30, 40 years later that some people are still adopting the internet. So we don't expect everyone to be on our page today. Right. You know, there can be some people who just feel right. Yeah, I get it. I see it. And some people that it's going to take more time. And that's like totally fine. We're not like, we're not preaching. We're just saying, look, here's something that needs to happen and is happening, and we're just going to help it along. So if you are interested and if you are thinking about ideas, a few things I have to say. What do we look for? We look for founders that have a global vision, so that they want to build a business that's going to be 100 million plus, multiple countries, So a big business, basically, and creating not just profit, because we do believe in profit, of course, right. But we also believe in purpose. And that purpose has to be either helping the environment. So I gave you the example of helping people eat a little bit less meat, or the example of society, which is about how do we stop mothers dying when they give birth.
Right.
These two things are environment and society, and we want people to help solve some of these problems through business. So you've got to have an idea that does that. You've got to be willing to give up initially 4 months of your time to come to London and spend it in our program, which is 161-hour MBA style, super intensive. You're dedicating a lot of your time. Well, you're working full time with us to take your business to the next level. And the expectations are really, really high of what you will do as a founder. So that's what we look for. Our applications are open right now. You can jump on unrest.world. It takes 7 minutes to fill in the application form. It's super, super easy. And we're beginning interviews in the next couple of months for our next cohort. But we run every 6 months, we run a cohort. So, you could be working on an idea today. And it might take you 6 months or a year. You might be listening to this in 2 years' time. Mm-hmm. We're still here. We're still running. We're still looking for amazing founders. So you can get involved at that level. There's also the level like beneath that, which is we share content on our social channels, LinkedIn, Instagram, etc. It's like free. We can start helping you think about your idea. We run open sessions. So we invite people to come and hear some of our talks, some of our workshops. So you can kind of eavesdrop on some of the stuff that we offer as part of our program. We really encourage you to like just start with something small and just begin that stone rolling down the hill, collecting moss, that analogy. Or just get in touch with us. Like we have people asking us for advice all the time. And we tend to say yes and help people.
Oh, that's great to hear. Fantastic. So, unfortunately, we are out of time for today, but please feel free anytime to come back and we'll definitely dive right back in or discuss other things or whatever it is you'd like to do. You're always welcome here at Hackcons. Yeah.
I'd love to come back, Chris. That was really, really fun. And thanks for doing what you do, man. It's really awesome. I enjoyed that.
Yeah, absolutely. And the same to you. Thank you so much for, not only, being an advocate, but, also an actor in actually making a difference because, we can all say, I don't want to use plastic straws, but who actually, goes out and tells someone how to do this without using plastic, So it's, there's few and far between and myself for sure. And I'm sure a lot of other people would genuinely thank you and Unrest for what you're doing.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I appreciate that. And thanks to you and the Tech Times for covering this and supporting us. Thanks so much.
Absolutely.